Before I get into this video, I need to give a little disclaimer. I'm going to be talking about doing something that involves 110 volt AC line voltage, which if mishandled or installed incorrectly, could lead to injury or death, potentially cause fire, and do several other bad things. I'm also going to be talking about a heater, which if mishandled or touched, could do the same. So if you are not comfortable in your skills in dealing with AC wiring or safely handling heater elements, then by all means, do not attempt any of the work that I am going to be doing here. Do another project, get a DC heater, which is much easier to handle safely. Again, do not hurt yourself trying to work with these products unless you are absolutely 100% sure of your abilities. West3D and its employees are not liable or responsible for any damages that could potentially occur from following the steps outlined in this video. That said, let's have some fun. If you've been paying attention to the pre-built printer market, you've probably seen or heard something about the Qidi Plus 4. It's a well-regarded printer with a nice feature set, and one of those features is that it comes with a built-in chamber heater. I was kind of interested when I saw the chamber heater itself is available as a separate part, as a replacement, so I picked one up and thought I would take a look at it and figure out how to integrate it within the Klipper environment for use in whatever projects you have in mind where you need a heater. This is the chamber heater. It has a nice big warning that says the hot air blowing out of the air outlet could be hot, could burn you. Here is the air inlet. If we take a look around the back, I have the back panel pulled off. Here is the 120 millimeter blower fan, which runs on 24 volts. This is the PTC heater element that runs on 110 volts. And there is a thermistor in the back here. Let me see if I can get that. There we go. So that you can monitor the temperature. Now, as I said, this is a 110 volt AC PTC heater, which means that when it is energized, you're going to have 110 volts on this heater element. The way that it works is 110 volts is fed into these metal fins, which have these white resistive elements in between sections. So this whole thing is just a very large resistive heat source. PTC heaters are capable of putting out a lot of heat very quickly. And I appreciate the fact that the way this heater assembly is put together, it's very difficult for you to accidentally touch the heater element. What I'm not as happy about with this design is that it does not incorporate a thermal fuse. So if you have any 3D printer that has a 110 volt bed heater on it, as an example, you will always have a thermal fuse. The reason being, the way the control works is you have an SSR, which controls the 110 volts going to the heater. If the SSR were to fail, it could potentially fail closed, which means your heater would be fed full power and bad things could happen. So the idea is you have a thermal fuse so that if your control system fails and your heater starts to overheat, once it hits a certain threshold, that fuse will blow, which will shut off power to the heater. This device does not have that. I'm sure that there could be an upstream relay that has to be energized for the heater to function. I haven't looked into the full layout of the Plus 4. But even at that, you're still relying on a software-controlled device so that if, for whatever reason, the system sees that the heater output is exceeding what you have it set for, that it would kill power to it. The absolute safest way is to use a thermal fuse. Most people are familiar with the ceramic fuses that we put on our heater beds. There are also these other style fuses, which is a metal fuse that you can get in various temperatures. And what you would do is fabricate a way to have this fuse touching the metal of the heater so that once the heater goes over the temperature threshold for the fuse you have chosen, this fuse will blow open and the heater will shut down. If you are installing a metal thermal fuse, keep in mind that while it should contact this heater directly, it cannot go across these fins without being insulated, or else it will short and bad things will happen. I'm not going to go through installing that here. I will be using this in a project. When I do that and I have everything figured out as far as how I'm mounting this, then I will absolutely be including the thermal fuse in the wiring. Having the thermal fuse is very important for safety. This drastically reduces the possibility that in the case of an equipment failure, you could accidentally touch a live circuit that you were not expecting to be energized. It can also eliminate, or at least drastically reduce, the chance that an out-of-control heater is going to get hot enough to melt plastic, to set a fire, to do anything bad. And when you are incorporating the thermal fuse, you absolutely must test it. So don't just buy one fuse. You know, these come normally in a pack of 10 or something. Make the mount to hold the fuse in place. You absolutely need to set the heater to a higher temperature than what your fuse is rated for. Confirm that the fuse will blow, then you need to replace it. It's the only way to know that your system is absolutely going to be thermally safe in case of an equipment failure. So I'm just going to set up a little bit of a test bench here so that I can show the operation of the heater. I am going to be controlling it with my switch wire here because the switch wire was already on the bench, and it also has a USB keystone on the back so that I can easily hook up this, which is the Klipper expander designed by Timmet. This is a great way to add more ports into a system with a small MCU that might not have enough ins and outs for what you're doing. This has four MOSFET inputs that can be used for anything from, I don't know, driving an SSR to controlling fans, doing whatever you need with that. This is the input for the MOSFET voltage. So whether you put 5, 12, or 24 volts in here, that's what's going to be fed on these outputs. There's a micro USB to hook it into your system. Since it was developed by Timmet, it has an RGB LED port. There are two thermistor inputs, as well as general digital I/O that's available for other uses. The other part of the equation is I have a Panasonic SSR, which I'm going to use to control the output of the heater. This is hooked up through a temporary 110 volt AC feed that I have on a power strip so that I can immediately switch off the power in case it's needed. So I'm going to go ahead and just hook up all the wiring, get the switch wire turned on, and then we can take a look at the software configuration. All right, so I have everything hooked up. I had forgotten to mention that I have my variable voltage bench supply, which is actually supplying the 24 volts for the Klipper expander to work with. Now let's take a look at the Klipper configuration. I've created a configuration file called chamberheater.cfg, which I've included in my printer.cfg. You can see I have the definition for the Klipper expander here. This is a line that just turns on the onboard LED, which is a status indicator that Klipper is connected. Here I have created a generic heater called chamber heater, very inventively. You need to give it the G-code ID of C so that Klipper understands what temperature unit we're looking at. This is hooked up to the heater pin on the expander, which is PA0. That's just MOSFET 0. I am running this at 0.75 max power. Full power is a little much, so just cutting it down a little bit makes it a bit more manageable, a little safer in my opinion. The sensor type, I'm just using the generic 3950 for the built-in thermistor, which is hooked up to thermistor 0, which is pin PA6. Now, I have enabled PID control, and I've already run a PID tune on the system. One thing to keep in mind is make sure that that thermal fuse that you're going to install, if you're doing this, has enough headroom, because before you PID tune the heater, you're going to get a pretty large overshoot. So for example, if your upper temperature range is going to be 80 degrees Celsius, you don't want to have a thermal fuse that blows at 85, maybe not even 90. Make sure you give it enough headroom so that you can PID tune without blowing a fuse. Looking back at the configuration, I have my max temp set at 60. For a chamber heater, it really shouldn't have to go that hot, so I would prefer to keep it in a lower, safer range. There is a verify heater section, so the system can check the operation of the heater. Then you can see I have a heater fan, which is the 120 millimeter blower fan, which is hooked up to MOSFET 1, which appears on PA1. Since this is a heater fan, I have it looking at the chamber heater itself so that anytime the temperature of that heater is above 20 degrees, then the fan will turn on. I have limited the fan speed to 0.75 because, again, since we're not letting the heater element run at 100%, there is a chance that you can provide too much cooling, at which point the heater won't be able to reach its target temperature because you're overcooling it. This is something that you will have to play with based on your configuration and your settings. And finally, I had included the initial setup for the chamber RGB port. When I implement this heater in a project, I'm planning on hooking up an RGB LED so that I can get real-time feedback on whether or not that is active and what the temperature range is. I'll probably be using LED effects to be able to show a temperature range based on the temperature setting. So now would be a good time to do some safety checks before I actually test this system. First of all, make sure your thermistor is working. Obviously, it is working here because if the thermistor wasn't working, Klipper would be giving us an error. The next thing you can do is to check the operation of the heater fan. So if I set the chamber heater to 25 degrees, the fan kicks on and you can see blinking lights over here. Let me turn that back off. If I were to let that run too long, then Klipper would most likely throw an error that the heater is not working at the expected rate. So now we know that if the target temperature is 20 or above, that the fan will automatically turn on. And I should have mentioned that I'm doing this with the AC turned off, so my heater element is not working yet. I'm just checking to make sure. Now I know my thermistor works. I know my fan works. Now with the power off, I'm going to set that to 25 degrees again, except this time I'm going to check the SSR. And I can see the LED there is blinking. So I know that the MOSFET on the Klipper expander is correctly controlling the SSR. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to turn on the AC power to the SSR. I have the live going through the SSR for control. I have the neutral connected to the PTC heater. I'm going to move my laptop and I'm going to set this up and let's go to 40 degrees. And looking at the temperature graph, you can see the temperature is going up. It's going up fairly quickly. And again, this is only at 3/4 power. And there we go. It's hit its 40 degree mark. That's nice and warm in this cold garage. From there, I can hit it up to 60. And it will just go on up. And we're just about at 60 degrees. Again, because I've already PID tuned, the system is intelligently... Oh. There we go. So what happened there? Well, let's take a look. What I did was I set the max temp at 60 degrees because that's where I wanted the system to max out. But even though this has been PID tuned, there is still a little bit of overshoot. So I'm going to change that max temp to 65. So as you go to integrate a heater like this into a system, you're probably going to have macros that control your heater. Just make sure that the maximum temperature you're calling for has a couple degrees of headroom between it and your max temp. Don't go right up to the max temperature because there is always going to be a little bit of overshoot, and that was just dumb on my part. So that's the system working. Now, to fully integrate this as a more intelligent chamber heater system, you're going to need a second thermistor. This thermistor is only good for regulating how much heat is being put out by this heating element. If you wanted to have this heat something like a dry box to keep your filament dry while it's being printed, you would have to have another thermistor to measure the temperature of the environment within that box. And then Klipper can vary the power of the heater to regulate the control within the box. I'm not going to get into a setup like that here. There are some good resources. I will link to one of them in the description of this video. So I hope you enjoyed this look at the Qidi chamber heater and the Klipper expander. They're both great tools that can let you do some interesting things. So stay tuned, and we're going to have more projects coming soon.